بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد ما بعد inshallah we'll continue with talking about the etiquettes in our life according to the deen of the Islam according to the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and we haven't had anything for the last couple of weeks but inshallah we'll continue last time we finished talking about the etiquettes of going to sleep and waking up inshallah today we'll talk about another adab or another etiquette that was regulated again by our deen, which is adab al-isti'than, the etiquettes of taking permission. Adab al-isti'than. The author says to start with adab dukhul al-buyut, the etiquettes of entering houses. By the way, this is something that is very important, and people want to have their privacy, and that's why this matter was regulated, so that no one can enter anywhere he wants at any time he wants without any regulation. But rather, there has to be a specific etiquette that have to be followed, so that the one would follow and not transgress over the people who are like living in a place, and this. Involved everyone, the old and the young, the men and the women, in a way that we'll see inshallah through the ayat and the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah An-Nur, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَدُخُلُوا بُيُوتًا غَيْرَ بُيُوتِكُمْ حَتَّى تَسْتَأْنِسُوا وَتُسَلِّمُوا عَلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ. An ayah in the meaning of which, O you who believe, do not enter houses that are not your houses until you make istinas. And I will come to say what that means. وَتُسَلِّمُ and make salam on its people. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ. Indeed, this is better for you, so that you might remember. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he said, حَتَّى تَسْتَأْنِسُوا, الاستئناس is in the meaning of الاستئذان. الاستئناس is in the meaning of الاستئذان or taking permission, and also it's in the meaning of الاستعلام. الاستعلام meaning that the one is making people aware that he is there and he's about to go in, rather than, you know, just walking in or looking through the window and surprising the people who are inside. But rather, the one should make a way of making people know, either by, you know, nowadays, like knocking on a bell, or like you know, using the bell, knocking on the door, or like, you know, in the form of, you know, one coughing, something like that, or, you know, making a sound in his throat, so that people know that there is someone, rather than being surprised. Allah subhanahu, and it was said in the meaning, like in the reason of the revelation of the ayah, like Imam al-Tabari had mentioned, is that a woman from among the Ansar, she came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she said that sometime I am at home in a situation or in a condition that I don't want anyone to enter upon me, even a father or a son. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this ayah in a way again to regulate our lives when it comes to such a thing, because it's true. Sometimes the one is in a condition that he doesn't want anyone, even the closest, to come upon him, right? Until he knows. He doesn't want a father, he doesn't want a mother, he doesn't want a son to enter upon him, until he's aware and he's, you know, taking preparation for that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said also in Surah An-Nur, فَإِذَا دَخَلْتُمْ بُيُوتًا فَسَلِّمُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ تَحِيَّةً مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ مُبَارَكَةً طَيِّبًا. So if you enter houses, then make salam on yourselves. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَسَلِّمُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ, make salam on your own selves in a way to say make salam on each other, right? Because all of us are are human beings, we have souls, and we are brothers under the brotherhood of Islam. So we are making salam. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, فَسَلِّمُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ, yani if you want to literally translate what the ayah means, is that make salam on your own selves, right? But your own selves means yourselves and others. So this is one of the things that actually one should do, even like within among his household. When the one enters the house and he has his wife, he has his kids, he lives with some of his relatives, the one should not just go and walk in and just go and do his own business without, you know, making salam. This is one of the ways of bringing the love and the tranquility inside homes and the peace, and to bring the barakah inside our homes to make the salam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said after that, تَحِيَّةً مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ مُبَارَكَةً طَيِّبًا. It's a salutation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had made for you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described it as مُبَارَكَةً طَيِّبًا. It's a blessed and it's a goodly way of salutation. And even if the one would enter, was narrated from among some of the Sahaba and the Tabi'een, that even if the one would enter his own house and there is no one say that is inside the house, and the one enters, it is recommended that the one would say assalamu alayna wa ala ibadillah as-salihin, that the one would say that salam on us and on the righteous slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whether the one enters and there are people, then definitely not to enter and not make salam on them, but rather the one enters the home, like we mentioned in the past, say Bismillah when he enters, and then make salam on others and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for khayr al-mulaj, for the betterment of the entry into his home. And when the one enters the home, like was mentioned in the hadith that we mentioned in the past, and he mentions the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the shaytan will say to the other shayateen that there is no mabit for you in this place, that there is no place for you to stay here tonight. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and then when he comes to eat and he mentions the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the shaytan will say, you have no place to stay, no mabit, and no food for you today, nothing for you to eat today, right? While the opposite, if the one enters and he doesn't mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this is the place where the shaytan can stay. And the shaytan stays and the troubles start, right? Troubles start from among the people who are inside, and also when it comes to being distracted from the ibadah, not having the tawfiq of making the ibadah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So again, when the one enters the home, this is one of the things that we have to remember, to mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then to make salam on people who are inside the home. Then the author said, كَيْفِيَةُ الْإِسْتِئِذَانِ. What is the way of making the الْإِسْتِئِذَانِ or taking permission? عن أبي موسى الأشعري رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا استأذن أحدكم ثلاثا فلم يؤذن له فليرجع. متفق عليه. أبو موسى الأشعري, may Allah pleased with him, he said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, if one of you takes permission, then let him do it three times, and then if he was not given permission, then he has to go back, right? And this hadith was narrated by Bukhari and Muslim. We'll read the next hadith inshallah, and then after that we'll continue. وعن ربعي قال حدثنا رجل من بني عامر أنه استأذن على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو في بيت فقال ألج, فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لخادمه أخرج إلى هذا فعلمه الاستئذان فقل له قل السلام عليكم أأدخل, فسمعه الرجل فقال السلام عليكم أأدخل, فأذن له النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فدخل. أخرجه أحمد وأبو داود. وحديث صحيح. Rib'i narrated that a man from the tribe of Bani Amr came to take a permission to enter upon the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم while he was at a house, and he said like this. He said, Alij, he said, do I enter? And this was the way he approached al-isti'dhan. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told to his servant, go out to this man and teach him how to make isti'dhan. So say to him, say, assalamu alaykum, adkhul, assalamu alaykum, shall I enter? So the man heard him and he said, assalamu alaykum, adkhul, assalamu alaykum, should I enter or shall I enter? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam gave him permission and he entered upon him sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So this is the way for the one to make isti'dhan, saying assalamu alaykum again, starting with the salutation and then asking for permission to enter. And whether this is something that can be heard. So for example, if you are about to enter and you see like part of the door is open and you see that people who are inside will be able to hear you, then this is the way to make isti'dhan. We have to remember that there's some differences. Because at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the places where they stay would not necessarily have, you know, like entry doors that would enter, like would cover the entrance, but rather that was something that people would be able to just like walk in. Nowadays we have doors and we have gates, right? And we have bells, for example. You have to ring the bell and you can knock on the door and all these things. So whatever is the way that the one is taking permission to enter, then he should take it. And he should use this method that he is using so that he would know the people who are inside that he wants to enter upon them, right, up to 3 times. And after that, he should go back if he was not given permission to go back. And the one, yani, should not have problem with that because all of us go through this, right? And sometimes you are in a situation where you cannot welcome guests, either because you are in a condition that you are busy with something, you have another priority, you know, for whatever reason you cannot meet that specific person at that time. So the one would take permission one time, for example, ring the bell one time, ring it another time, ring it a third time, and then after that, leave. Give people excuses like just like you would like it for yourself, and we should not have hard feelings when it comes to not being allowed to enter. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said in another hadith that was narrated by Abdullah bin Busr, may Allah please with him, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam كان إذا أتى باب قوم لم يستقبل الباب من تلقاء وجهه ولكن من ركنه الأيمن أو الأيسر ويقول السلام عليكم السلام عليكم. أخرجه أحمد وأبو داود والحديث صحيح. So Abdullah bin Busr, may Allah please with him, he described how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would come at the entrance for a place where people are living, and he would say that he sallallahu alayhi wasallam would not face the door with his face, but rather he would face either the right side or the left side, and then he would say assalamu alaykum assalamu alaykum. So if this was the entrance like this, like I would not just face it with my face, but rather I would look to one side or the other and then say assalamu alaykum assalamu alaykum. And the reason of that is that, you know, if you look just like to the entrance, that it is likely that you will see the people inside before they had taken preparation and given permission. In Aun al-Ma'bud, in the explanation of the hadith of Abu Dawood, he said, أي مقابل وجهه وحداءه لكي لألا يقع بصره على أهل البيت لكن يستقبله من الانحراف والميل من ركنه الأيمن أو الأيسر أي من أحد جانبيه الأنسب بالوقوف. That he would take precautions when he is about to take permission, even at the moment of taking permission, so that the one would just not look inside without having given permission first. The hadith mentions that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam repeated it twice, assalamu alaykum assalamu alaykum. The habit of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was to, whether he would say something, to repeat it 3 times, or whether to ask for permission to ask it 3 times. And يعني it is mentioned here at twice, like if it was enough for people to listen. So for example, you say السلام عليكم and someone give you permission, that's enough. So السلام عليكم twice and someone give you permission, then it's twice. Then it is enough. But if it takes that no one is giving you permission yet, then you try three times and then after that you stop and you depart. Then he said, استئذان المماليك والصغار. What is the way of taking permission for those who are young and those who are like owned, like the slaves? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لِيَسْتَأْذِنْكُمُ الَّذِينَ مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ لَمْ يَبْلُغُوا الْحُلُمَ مِنْكُمْ ثَلَاثَ مَرَّاتٍ من قبل صلاة الفجر وحين تضعون ثيابكم من الظهيرة ومن بعد صلاة العشاء ثلاث عورات لكم ليس عليكم ولا عليهم جناح بعدهن طوافون عليكم بعضكم على بعض كذلك يبين الله لكم الآيات والله عليم حكيم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, O you who believe, let those who you you possess, meaning the slaves, and those who have not reached the age of puberty from among the children, let them or teach them to take permission to make isti'than three times at three occasions before Salat al-Fajr. This is one. وحين تضعون ثيابكم من الظهيرة, and when you put down your clothes at the time of the middle of the day. ومن بعد صلاة العشاء, and after صلاة العشاء, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, ثلاث عورات لكم. Those are three times that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described as عورات. عورات, why? Because it's likely for the one to be exposed during this time, before Fajr, at the middle of the day when people used to relax and take a nap, and then after عشاء when they are getting to go and get sleep. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, ليس عليكم ولا عليهم جناح بعدهن. Then beyond these three times, there is no junah, meaning that they are not blameworthy to enter upon you without permission. And this is for the slaves and for the young kids that did not reach the age of puberty. طوافون عليكم بعضكم على بعض, because the nature of them is that they are those who would enter upon you naturally, because this is the way they are, right? You know, a young kid is running around and he's entering, right? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, كَذَلِكَ يُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ الْآيَاتِ. This is as such that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is explaining to you the ayat, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ. He is the all-knower, the all-wise subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you ponder about this, يعني, and kids that are young, many things to be learned from this ayah. And you can see how the etiquette of the isti'than had involved everything, like even the small kids. For those who are kids and at a young age, oftentimes we think about them that, you know, let them do whatever they want, and then when they get older, then at that time they can, you know, we can teach them because they are still too young. But this is not the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us. This is something that has to be taught to them even when they are younger, so that they would grow up with it. We'll bring some examples that Imam al-Bukhari had mentioned in Adab al-Mufrad, that shows how they were, yani the early generation would teach the youngsters from when they are very young, so that when they grow up they are prepared, rather than the one, you know, waiting for his kid to reach the age of puberty and be like a teenager, and then there's nothing that you have no control over him, basically. This is something that we can see with many aspects, not when it comes only to making the isti'than. So for example, who doesn't like his kid to grow up and be someone who would come to the masjid and be righteous and religious? Everyone wants him, right? But what happens is that we neglect the kids until they are like grown up, and then after that we come and say, well, why don't you do this? Why don't you do that? And then we come and say, well, we have no control over our kids. While when they were 7 and 8 and 9, they are very lenient, right? Whatever you teach them, they will adopt, and they will take it as a habit in their life, right? And then they will grow up with it and it will become something natural in their behavior. And this is the time this is the time to teach, and this is the time that to have them adopt habits, because otherwise they will be out of control, and they have whatever habits they had, they had it already, right? So when it comes, for example, to coming to the masjid, you come to the masjid, or to start with, definitely, and we have to fix our own selves, and we have to be good examples for the kids if we want them to be good. Because if we are deficient in something, we can never, like, you know, get it over to our kids. So we have to be in ourselves, be good, and be good examples, abide to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all aspects, apply the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the details of our life. And if we do that, then they will see that to start with, right? And then after that comes to the level of commanding them and teaching them and having them do the things that you want after they have seen it on you. So they see that you go to the masjid, for example, all the time. And then you order them to come with you to the masjid when they are 7 and 8 and 9 years of old. And then they grow up and they become like that. Otherwise, they will be like, you know, 13, 14, 15 or 20, and they are away from the masjid, and you know, they were never called to come to the masjid. Sometimes we even bring them to the, you know, Maghrib and Isha prayer maybe once or twice a week, and we neglect the rest of the week. Or sometimes we bring them only to the day of the Jum'ah. And what will stick in their minds is that, well, this masjid is a masjid that I go to on Fridays. This what will be stuck in their minds, because this is what they were ordered to do. Maybe this is what they saw, like, their parents doing only, right? And then after that, even to go to beyond that, you know, when we grow up, we, you know, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides one of us to come for the congregational prayer and to come for Maghrib and Isha, for example, every day, and we see that a brother is consistent in doing that, we'll come to him and say, mashallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had made it easy for you to come for Maghrib and Isha. Why don't we see you, brother, on Fajr prayer? You know, and then it takes struggle and struggle and struggle for the one to be consistent in praying Isha and praying Fajr in Jama'ah. طيب, the question is, why don't we teach our kids to come to the Fajr prayer when they are young? Is that, like, do we think that we have more mercy on them than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when it comes to ordering them to come to the masjid? We've seen this, and sometimes the parents, like, feel like, you know, that the kid is, you know, needs like extra hour of sleep, then let him sleep and let him not wake him up. Then whenever he wakes up, he sleeps. He can pray. And sometimes they have even reached the age of puberty, and we just keep them because they are young. Although, once they reach the age of puberty, they are responsible for their actions, right? But the idea is that, see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that they have to take permission before Salat al-Fajr, right? Min qabli Salat al-Fajr. Why would they be awake on Salat al-Fajr if they used to deal with them the way we deal with our kids nowadays, right? The kids are left and the sunrise would come, and then after that they would wake up and then they can pray whenever they want. I mean, how come they would have the idea of that the Fajr prayer has to be prayed before sunrise? Why isn't that when the one wakes up for the Fajr prayer, he wakes up his kids? Why isn't that he brings them over for the Fajr prayer? If you want them to have enough sleep, then teach them the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that they would sleep right after Isha. Sleep right after Isha, wake up at Fajr, this is more than enough. And then you are actually investing in your kid, rather than, you know, being the reason for the forgetfulness of your kid. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yani, maybe I had some, you know, I was a little bit strong in my phrases, but this is something that really, really brings the sadness. When you see, like, people coming and the masajid are not having, like, kids, although you know that this person has, like, a 10-year-old or 11-year-old or an 8-year-old. Bring them to the masajid, inshallah, so that they can get used to it, and bring them to pray in the masajid like the salah in the masajid has to be established. Not every now and then, not in a, like, you know, in one prayer or two, or just like a Friday prayer, but rather make them know that this is the way the Muslim should يعني, pray his prayer when it comes to the men of this Ummah. So this is when they are before the age of puberty. Once they reach the age of puberty, then they have to make isti'than at all the time, right? So this is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned these three times occasionally, like specifically, the before Fajr and at the middle of the day, waqt al-dhahira, and then after the Isha, those are the times that even the young kids that do not, يعني, did not reach the age of puberty and are still considered young have to take permission, right? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the following ayah, وَإِذَا بَلْغَ الْأَطْفَالُ مِنْكُمُ الْحُلُمَ فَلْيَسْتَأْذِنُوا كَمَا اسْتَأْذَنَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. And if the kids reach the age of puberty, then they have to take permission like those who were before them, meaning those who have reached the age of adulthood, meaning now they are responsible. And the original status is that the one would take permission all the time. Is that clear? So there is difference between like the young kid who did not reach the age of puberty, he takes permission at these three times. Once the age of puberty is reached, then he has to take permission at all times. One of the other etiquettes is that the one takes permission even when he is, we have talked about entering homes, to talk about taking permission of the company that the one is with. The Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith that was narrated by Abdullah bin Mas'ud, he said, إِذَا كُنْتُمْ ثُلَاثَ فَلَا يَتَنَاجَ اثْنَانِ دُونَ صَاحِبِهِمَا فَإِنَّ ذَلِكَ يُحْزِنُهُ. The Prophet ﷺ said in this hadith, and you can see this, like, you can see this great etiquette, that he said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, that if you were three, then let not two of you talk to you in a silent, like in a secret dialogue without the third one, because that will make him sad. This hadith was agreed upon, read by Al-Bukhari and Muslim. And you know, this is something that, see how our deen even involved this etiquette, that if three people are like together, then two of them should not be having a personal dialogue and leaving the third one without having someone to talk to him. Why? Because this will bring sadness into him, right? So we have to be cognitive about that, because sometimes you don't pay attention to it. And it can even apply to people like being three together, two of them that understand a language that the third doesn't. And then they start talking with the language that the third person doesn't understand. Then the same meaning of the hadith applies. Why? Because they are talking and they are neglecting him. Now, if they were four or five or some like more than that, then there's no harm in two people to having like a dialogue between themselves, because he has someone to talk to. But if he was left alone, in case they make this dialogue among themselves only, then this is something that they should not do it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited from that. And the ulama said, like Imam Nawawi said in the explanation of the hadith, that this prohibition in the hadith is for tahrim, meaning that it's haram for them to do that. It's not only something that is disliked, but rather he went with the opinion that this is something that is haram, meaning that if they do that, then and the sadness happens to the person who was left alone, the third person, then they have committed sins. Also, one of the things that we have to be aware of, one of the etiquettes is that the one should not look inside a place without the permission of his the people who are inside. Abu Huraira, may Allah pleased with him, he narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لو أن رجلا اطلع عليك بغير إذن فحذفته بحصاة ففقأت عينه ما كان عليك من جناح. متفق عليه. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that if a man would look at you inside your place without your permission, and you throw a stone and you blow his eye, there is no harm on you. Meaning you haven't done anything wrong. To show how much our deen is stressing the rights of the people, and that the privacy is protected. And No one should look inside, and sometimes that happens. You see windows that are open, and you look inside what the people inside are doing. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this hadith that is agreed upon, made by al-Bukhari and Muslim, that if the one does that and you throw a stone and it happens that you mess up his eye, then there's no harm on you, you haven't done anything wrong. Again, because his behavior was the wrong behavior, and he is the one who looked at things that he did not look at. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the other hadith, إِنَّمَا جُعِلَ الْإِسْتِئْذَانُ لِأَجْلِ الْبَصَرِ أو من أجل البصر. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that istidhan, taking permission, originally why was it made? Why the istidhan was made? It was made من أجل البصر, for protection of the eyesight. Why? Because if the one would enter without taking permission, then his eyes might fall into things that the people in the place do not want them to look at. And it can be taken from this hadith that even on the maharim, you know, sometimes you have a daughter, sometimes you have, a mother that you enter upon, still you have to make a way of making them know that you are entering upon them, because even though those are people who they can, for example, expose their part of their body like they do not to others because they are your maharim, you should still not enter upon them because your eyes might fall into parts of them that they wanted to cover and not have you see them. Al-Imam al-Bukhari, and we'll end up with this, Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he narrated some of the narrations from the Sahaba and the Tabi'een that shows some of those etiquettes. And Al-Imam ibn Hajar, he collectively narrated, and he brought those ahadith that was narrated by Imam al-Bukhari, and he showed that their ways were authentic. So these ahadith that were mentioned from the way of the Sahaba and the Tabi'een that I will mention were mentioned by Imam al-Bukhari, and they were all with authentic narrations. عن نافع قال كان ابن عمر إذا بلغ ولده الحلم لم يدخل عليه حتى يستأذن. He said Nafi' is the known servant who was among the ulama, because he accompanied Abdullah ibn Umar for a long time. He said Ibn Umar used, if his son would reach the age of puberty, then he would not enter upon him until he takes permission. And this is the son would not enter upon his father just like that, but rather he would take permission first. ومن طريق علقمة جاء رجل إلى ابن مسعود فقال. A man came to Ibn Mas'ud and he said, أستأذن على أمي. He said, should I take permission to enter upon my mother? So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he replied to him and he said, ما على كل أحيانها تريد أن تراها. He said that she probably doesn't want you to see her in all her conditions. Even though it's your mother, right? She might be in a situation where she doesn't want to see you. She doesn't want you to see her as such, right? Meaning that yes, take permission. You have to take permission when you enter upon her. And in another narration, سأل رجل حذيفة. A man asked حذيفة, another صحابي or the صحابة of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. أستأذن على أمي. He said to him, should I take permission upon entering on my mother? He said, إِنْ لَمْ تَسْتَأْذِنْ عَلَيْهَا رَأَيْتَ مَا تَكْرَهُ. He said, if you do not take permission, then you might see something that she doesn't like you to see. Again, the answer is to take permission when the one enters even upon his maharim, like his mother. وعن طريق موسى بن طلحة. موسى بن طلحة narrates a story that happens with him when he was a kid. And he says, دخلت مع أبي على أمي. فدخل واتبعته فدفع في صدري وقال تدخل بغير ابن. He said, I entered with my father on my mother. So he was like, happens with everyone. He the one with his kid, right? And he's with his father. They both enter on the mother, right? So the father and the son would enter on the wife of the father and the son and the mother of the son, right? So he said, I entered with my father upon my mother, and as we were entering together, he pushed me in my chest, and he said, are you entering without taking permission? And you can see like how he's teaching his kid, right? Although they were like entering together, and this is something that happens like very often, right? You don't even think about it, but see how they were teaching their kids so that they would not do such a thing. Although this is something you might say, well, he's entering upon his mother. But again, if he doesn't remember that and he is not taught that when he is young, how is he going to adopt that when he becomes older? وَمِن طَرِيقِ عَطَاءٍ قَالْ Also Ata, one of the tabi'in, he said, سَأَلْتُ ابْنَ عَبَّاسِ I asked Ibn Abbas, أَسْتَأْذِنُ عَلَىٰ أُخْتِي He said, should I take permission to enter upon my sister? He said, yes. فَقَالْ So the man said, or Ata said, إِنَّهَا فِي حِجْرِي Meaning that she is with me and I am the one who's taking care of her. So Ibn Abbas told him, أَتُحِبُّ أَن تَرَاهَا عُرْيَانَ That would you like to see her naked? Meaning that again, even though she is your sister, you are like older than her and you are taking care of her, you are, you know, in charge of all of her affairs and she's under your protection, all these things. Still, you take permission because otherwise the one might enter upon her and she might be in a way that she doesn't want the one, she's not prepared and she doesn't want someone to see her. So with that, we have finished the adab al-istidhan and what was mentioned in this book. وَصَلَى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمُ وَبَارَكَ نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدُ وَعَلَى الْمُصَحْبِ أَجْمِلُونَ